Hello and welcome back to Continental Club, where we discuss the hottest topics in European football. The hottest topic this week was, of course, the Champions League, and that is what we are focusing on today with Michael McCubbin and Henry Hill. Specifically, dark horses, because at Folds, Ashley said, are PSG genuine contenders for the Champions League after their loss to United? Now, we've talked about PSG recently on the Extra Time podcast, so we wanted to flip this question around, Folds, Ashley. I hope that's all right with you. And instead, we're going to talk about United and some other possible dark horses, because there's been some promising performances so far this year, and we want to really delve into them and see whether that's just a game week fluke, let's say, game week one fluke, I should say, or whether they have a strong chance of actually winning the trophy this year. But before we dive into that, just a quick reminder to subscribe to Euro Football Daily and hit that notification bell to never miss a Continental Club, I should say. We do shows like this every single week, and they are well informed and very, very long. So without further ado, let's kick off, Henry, with Lazio, because what a week for them.
Yes, a really surprising victory, I think. I think most Lazio fans would agree in their opening day victory against Borussia Dortmund in Rome. And it's a great return for the Eagles to the Champions League. To give you an idea, the last time they were in the competition was 13 years ago. And they had Alexander Kolarov and Goran Pandev in their squad, which quite remarkably, they're still playing, still going strong today in Serie A for Inter and Genoa, respectively. So, you know, quite incredible careers all considered. But yeah, I mean, to give you a context, going into this game, they really weren't in a great shape of form. They had just one win from their last four games that left them in 15th. I mean, to be fair to them, they had a tough start playing Atalanta, who trounced them 4-1. Gasperini's high-scoring outfit, who also won their opening game, Mitty Jans, very comfortably away in Denmark. And with Inter Milan, that was pretty bad-tempered 1-1 draw. And then Immobile was missing. So I get a lot of stick on the channel for the way I say his name. So I'm going to really try and
focus. Italian, mate.
Yeah, Immobile. So yeah, without the suspended Immobile, plus six others for injury, they suffered a 3-0 loss to Sampdoria on the weekend. They'd got 0 of their 10 shots and targets, which shows you that they're not really, when he's not around, they're not doing great. And also, this league form continued their sort of poor end to last season, where they lost six of their final 12 games to finish fourth. I think, well, there was a lot of hype about whether or not they were going to sort of win the league and push Juventus, but it kind of really just fell off in the end. But yeah, in this game, they beat Dortmund 3-1 at home. And although the scoreline flattered them slightly, they edged BVB 1.78 to 1.53 on expected goals. But they did deserve to win it nonetheless. I mean, they took advantage of sort of like a minor injury crisis, you could say, at the back for Dortmund at the moment. They've got Akanji's injured, Dan Axel Zagadou's injured as well. I think Nico Schulz and some other options. So as a result, they played a back three where Thomas Delaney, the Danish international, had to slip in at left centre-back with 35-year-old Piszczek, who I keep thinking he's retired, but he's still going. He dropped in at right centre-back. And, you know, Immobile and his friends, they realised this was their moment. So they really went after them. Amazingly, Immobile was the man of the match. He scored the opener and assisted Jean-Daniel Akpro, who's one of their new additions this summer. I think they only got it for about $2 million, so a pretty tidy pickup for the third, and notched up three shots overall. Erling Haaland was the only player who got more on the pitch, but you know, you come to expect that from Haaland these days. And it was a pretty kind of classic Italian performance in that they didn't hold on to lots of the ball. They sort of sat deep. They only had 35% possession. But they were super effective on the counter, with just three of their 11 shots coming from outside the box. They're really getting in and where it matters. And forgive me, I can't remember his name, but it was Dortmund's backup keeper who had a bit of a tricky...
Heinz, is he called? Or something like that.
Heinz. Yeah, he had a bit of a... tricky arrival in the Champions League, so that's tough for him. Also, one of their other high performers in the squad was Francesco Acerbi. He was also excellent at left centre back. He won all of his tackles, completed two dribbles, second only to Sancho, who was disappointed, not really in the game at all, and he also created three chances, which was the most on the pitch. And if we look at, you know, how he's performing in the league this season, he's averaging 7.8 tackles and interceptions per game in Serie A. So, you know, it shows Acerbi's really sort of stepped up his game this year. And if we just sort of look at Lazio as a squad, they had, you know, it's a really interesting summer business. They managed to get Andres Pereira on a loan deal through from Manchester United. Who knows? They've got Vedat Muriqi, who we talked a lot about in pre-season, from Fenerbahce for $15 million. He should hopefully be a good addition to Immobile up front. And they've held, managed to hold on to some of their other guys like Correa and also Milinkovic-Savic, who, you know, the Serbian international, maybe rated somewhere between 50, 70 million, I think. Linked with United a fair amount of times, and he's beginning to show his worth on the bigger stage. He scored recently in the Euros playoffs against Norway, and you know he's currently averaging 2.8 shots, 3.1 tackles and interceptions per game, as well as 0.5 expected goals and assists per 90. So he's a pretty solid, excellent addition in the centre of midfield. And Immobile, you know, he's still scoring after his 36 goal tally last year. And you know, I was just talking to you guys that, you know, a lot of the Lazio squad are really quite bemused that he's not being held up in the same regard as Lewandowski for his exploits last season. It's sort of like a, if the Ballon d'Or did exist, it's sort of a shoo-in conclusion that Lewandowski would take it. But at the same time, Immobile, it was an incredible season last year, and he sort of kicked on again. You know, he scored 56% of their total output. And as we mentioned earlier, when he's not around, it shows what's happened. But yeah, it's a really good opportunity for Lazio to look forward and press on in this group. They've got Zenit and Club Brugge to come. You know, Club Brugge, my outside shout, who already have listened to my call to arms and went and beat Zenit 2-1 in Russia, which is a pretty remarkable result. It was a smash and grab last minute kind of victory there. So they've got a lot to play for now. I think Dortmund can recover. I think they, you know, they've still got amazing players. They just need to sort their defence out. But Lazio can look at the next few games and really think, if we can pick up 6 more points from this group, get 9, and go into sort of the changeover of fixtures, they could be in a really strong position to do something. Because like I said, it was a brilliant opening result for them. And yeah, I think it's really optimistic time for them to be back in the Champions League after what's been a disappointing sort of last few months.
Yeah, 100%. They needed this result to get their season going. And they were outstanding in that first half. Dortmund did come into it a lot in the second half, and potentially it could have been a bit of a tighter game in the end, but they'll be kind of disappointed that they didn't manage to find Sancho in more dangerous areas. You know, in the highlights that I was watching, he was dropping so deep, obviously trying to make things happen, but that's not really where you want him. You want him on the end of things. Giovanni Reyna didn't produce quite his best performance either, but I think you're right. When Dortmund get their centre-backs back and get some semblance of a regular backline going, they'll be absolutely fine. But for Lazio, fantastic work all round. McCubs, let's move on to Man United, because you must have been absolutely on top of the world on Tuesday night.
Yeah, I was. It was just a really entertaining game, wasn't it? And in particular, from a United perspective, PSG were obviously very poor. You know, if you want to hear more about that, we did chat about that, or you and Joe chatted about it, didn't you, Doogie, on Wednesday's...
we did indeed.
On Wednesday's UCL review, at least from a PSG perspective, in terms of where they really lacked. But yeah, I mean, similarly to Lazio, you know, United fans haven't begun this season in particularly optimistic kind of form, as it were, because yeah, United's first, you know, 3-4 games were disastrous. You know, aside from that kind of 3-2 win over Brighton, obviously they lost the other two games, but even that game against Brighton, United were very not convincing at all. And unlike Lazio, it wasn't like they were coming up against the best sides in the division either. You know, Lazio did have, you know, those tough games against Atalanta and Inter, which I didn't think they actually played too badly in. Whereas, yeah, United did look particularly hapless in defence, which is somewhere they improved last season. And I think that was the main thing for me in this game against PSG, was that the defence just looked so much better. Obviously, you know, Ole has utilised that 3-2, 3-5-2 before in big games. I think Mourinho used to do it actually at United as well. And they, you know, generally it has come off for United in those big games. Axel Tuanzebe and Wan-Bissaka obviously were very impressive in dealing with Mbappe. I think Tuanzebe made 7 clearances in the end, which is the most on the pitch. Wan-Bissaka clocked up 8 tackles and interceptions, and kind of away from the numbers, generally Tuanzebe tended to win his duels with Mbappe, which I think, you know, very impressive for a guy who hasn't played since November 2019. When you look at it from like an expected goal standpoint, PSG actually weren't that bad. I think like they did cause United problems at points in the game, which kind of shows in the XG. Non-penalty XG has it as 0.7 to United and 1.1 to PSG. So obviously that's not including the Fernandes penalty. That's also not including the Martial own goal. So, you know, David De Gea did have to be on top form to keep them at bay. And I was thinking throughout the game that really, I think, you know, a better side than United, say a Liverpool or a Man City, I think would have been like 3-0 up against PSG at half time. I think United were quite wasteful in the final third, which I think probably explains why it took so long for them to you know, retake the lead through Marcus Rashford. But I think on the balance of play and just the general play, it was clear who was the better team. I think Fred and McTominay really dominated that midfield. I think they won possession around 12 times between them. Fred was essential in the transition, as he has been in big games for United. I think he completed two dribbles, completed 90% of his passes as well. So he kind of really showed that, you know, really kind of repaid Solskjaer's faith for including him over Pogba in the side. But I think, yeah, Bruno Fernandes. I think if United are to progress kind of to, say, the quarterfinals in this competition, then I think Bruno Fernandes is going to be the key for him, for them. Like, he made five tackles, he took four shots, most of them outside the box, granted, but still, you know, still was a threat throughout the game. Also created two chances. You know, he already has three goals and two assists in four Premier League appearances this term, which is pretty impressive considering United have been rubbish aside from that Newcastle game. Only KDB is actually averaging more than his four key passes per 90 in the league as well. So I know he gets, you know, I know he gets a little bit of stick from, you know, a lot of his goals coming from penalties and whatnot, but he really is essential to that United attack. You know, even when Rashford or Martial are having off days, you know, he's the one who really steps up. So yeah, and I think, you know, similarly to Lazio, although United did spend a lot more, you know, United fans were pretty disappointed with their summer business. But having said that, the players that they have brought in do have a lot of UCL pedigree. Obviously, Alex Telles has, you know, been playing almost every season for Porto. Donny van de Beek, although he's very young, was, you know, has been a key player to Ajax's kind of exploits in Europe in the last 3 years. Edinson Cavani, of course, needs no introduction. And I think they've clocked up 128 appearances in the competition between them. So they've got players who, you know, who are used to, you know, big UCL nights. And Solskjaer as well, at least in the very limited games he's managed in the competition, has done all right as well. Obviously, this was his second win against PSG in as many games away, at least. But I think, yeah, I think a lot will come down to his tactics, because, you know, they are still in a tough group. You know, they have come through one of the harder ties, but they still have to, you know, come up against PSG at home, where there might be a little bit more pressure on them. You'd expect Tuchel to maybe alter his tactics as well. And, you know, he's going to be facing Nagelsmann twice as well. And I think Leipzig are easily going to be a tougher challenge, I think. You know, that they press very high, don't they? And United, under Solskjaer, I think that has been one of their weak points, especially with that defence in kind of inconsistent form. I think they might struggle against that high Leipzig press. So they've got them next week, and they've got a trip to Başakşehir the week after. They're a little bit more of an unknown entity, aren't they? Başakşehir did very well last season, but last time I checked, they were bottom of the Super League this term. So they've had a pretty poor start to the start to the season. So yeah, I think, yeah, like with the teams we're talking about, I think, yeah, United, you know, realistically are, you know, aren't going to be a contender to actually win it, but could definitely, you know, on the basis of Tuesday's result, I think, you know, a quarterfinal place is not out of the question. That would be a great achievement, I think. But yeah, I think it all comes down to really Ollie's tactics in big games. If he can, you know, if he can actually go toe-to-toe with Nagelsmann, I'd be really impressed.
Yeah, I think sorry, Henry, far away.
Sorry, I was just... I was just wondering, you know, cause just to sort of like touch on Ford's, Ashley's question itself, because obviously you both watched that game. What, I mean, just briefly, like, what did you learn about PSG which might actually worry you? Because as well, as good as, you know, as good as United were, and it was quite an impressive performance, surely there were limits to PSG and what they did there. Because if you look at their defence, for example, with Wan-Bissaka out for most of the season, Kajawa, I don't believe he's a sort of world-class left back. Kimpembe has now obviously had to step up quite a lot, and even at right back, they're kind of limited in their options there. You know, Alessandro Florenzi straight in, and they're having to play like Igana Gay and the Herrera centre mid, and they're going quite a defensive midfield structure there. And it does, they're having to sort of compensate for the fact maybe their defence isn't quite as strong, and maybe like PSG's undoing this year is going to be their kind of limited defensive ability. I was just wondering what you two, having seen the game, sort of thought about that.
I think they massively missed Verratti, to be honest. Like, I was, you know, quite buoyed by the fact that Verratti was missing for that game, because he's such a key player for them, and they have, you know, compensated without him in the past. But I think that was it. Like, the midfield was just so porous, and without, like, you know, without that world-class presence of Verratti in there, I think that was, that's always going to be key for them as well. Yeah, Marquinhos, I don't think was fully fit. So without either of them in there, it's just, I just don't think that midfield is particularly good. I'm not sure what you thought, Dukes.
Yeah, I didn't think it was particularly good, that midfield. It didn't seem like the right combination for that game as well. I thought Fred and McTominay actually completely dominated, really. Their work rate was so much better than Danilo Pereira's. It was so much better than Ander Herrera's as well. But PSG, you know, they had their moments going forward as well. But Angel Di Maria and Neymar only created one chance between them. It was really sort of Mbappe and Mbappe only. And actually, with both of them pulling left, Mbappe and Neymar so often, down Wan-Bissaka and Tounzebi's channel, who was having a magnificent game on the right-hand side. I mean, PSG just didn't really carry much threat. But if you want a more detailed analysis of what went down in that game specifically, go check out Wednesday's UCL review, which drops at 9 a.m. on that day. But let's move on to another team in this year's competition, in Borussia Mönchengladbach, who got a fantastic result last night, filming this on a Thursday in the San Siro. But similar to Lazio, don't have much pedigree in the competition. They actually haven't competed in it since 2016-17, when they finished third in a group behind Barcelona and Man City. So a really difficult group. But they were excellent in last year's Bundesliga, we have to say. They finished fourth, but they're only 4 points behind second place Dortmund. And it was really their sort of, they were pretty good going forward. They had a good sort of goal difference in the end. But it was really their defence that made the major difference. So only Bayern with 32 and Leipzig with 37 conceded fewer than their 40 league goals. And they had a very quiet summer in terms of incomings, as did many teams throughout Europe and particularly in Germany. Their only major permanent signing was 17-year-old right-back Joe Scally, who came over from New York City FC, who was signed for £1.6 million. Yeah. Exactly, Joe Scallywag. but they did manage to bring in a couple of players on loan. They brought in Valentino Lazzaro from Inter Milan, the sort of versatile right-back who actually played pretty well for Newcastle at the back end of last campaign. Was quite surprised they didn't make that permanent. Maybe he just didn't fancy it up north. And they also brought in Hannes Wolf, the sort of promising RB Leipzig forward. But crucially, they kept hold of all their best players. They kept hold of Marcus Thuram, Brilem Mbolo, Alisson Player, Florian Neuhaus, Dennis Zakaria, etc. But like Lazio and like Man United, they put aside a mediocre start to the season last night. So in the league, they've only won one of their opening four games. And they currently sit 11th. Although expected goals suggest there isn't too much to worry about. They're actually rated as the fifth best side after those four games. So you'd expect them to climb the table as they find a bit more consistency and get off that sort of early season. It's not really rust. I don't really know what it is. It's the fatigue that most teams in Europe seem to be experiencing. But there wasn't really any of that in display last night. Like Lazio and Man United, they very much used it as a springboard. They only conceded in the final minute from Lukaku to draw 2-2. XG suggests, you know, 2-2 actually flattered them. They had it at 2.4 to 0.6 in Inter's favour, which isn't really a surprise when, you know, they started with the likes of Lukaku and Sanchez up front, and then Lautaro Martinez came on, hit the post with an excellent effort as well. So the firepower that Inter have is, and sort of the quality they have throughout their side is really fantastic. I would say that Inter need to stop making such basic errors at the back, though. Vidal in this game, really silly challenge. Kolarov at the weekend against AC Milan. You're not going to get anywhere into Milan if you keep throwing away goals. But back to Gladbach, because they've got a player in Marcus Thuram who will cause a threat to anyone. And I don't think Real Madrid or Shakhtar Donetsk will enjoy playing him one bit. Last night, 5 tackles and interceptions working from the left wing. Fantastic. 6 aerial duels won. I mean, little surprise when he's about 6'4", I think. 4 dribbles and 1 shot. Nico Elvedi, I've been talking about him on the podcast for about a year and a half now. I think he's an excellent centre-back. He was brilliant last night as well. 10 tackles and interceptions, 6 aerial duels won as well, 1 dribble completed. But actually, their player of the moment is Jonas Hofmann, who's absolutely on fire at the start of this season. 2 goals and 3 assists in 5 league and Champions League games. He can play on the left or the right. And they've actually got quite a nice amount of backup in forward areas. They've got Patrick Herrmann. They've got Lars Stindl that they can bring off the bench. And these are, you know, along with Alisson Player and Brilem Mbolo, they've got quite a flexible, fluid system. Quite a good roster of attacking players. But Hofmann is the key man at the moment. 2 shots and 3.3 key passes per 90. That's absolutely superb. And 0.56 expected goals and assists per 90, which again is very good for a player playing for Gladbach. They've got Real Madrid at home in their next game. I don't think Real Madrid, on the basis of the display last night, will be going into that with a lot of confidence. And then they've got Shakhtar away. If they get 3 points from one of those games, 3 points at least, then I think Borussia Mönchengladbach are in with an outside bet of qualifying from this sort of second group of death, along with that Ajax, Atalanta and Liverpool group. So I'm quietly confident about Gladbach and what they could do in this year's competition. If not, drop into the Europa League. I think they'll have a good run in that. But guys, the key question now, who is going to go furthest in this year's competition? Lazio, Man United or Gladbach? What do you reckon, Henry?
Ooh, that's a tricky. I would say, I'd say for the pedigree of sort of competing at a high level for most of the time, I'd probably say Manchester United.
Okay.
Out of those three. But I, by the way, big up Shakhtar Donetsk. To have had 10 players missing with injury or various viruses and whatnot, to go and beat Real Madrid, and whose first half display is one of the worst I've ever seen from a Real Madrid side. Their defence just wasn't in a line ever. It was truly shocking. But yeah, big up Shakhtar Donetsk. I thought that was a really, you know, really impressive result from a fairly like consistent, steady Champions League side as well. You know, that group is so interesting. But yeah, to answer your question, Manchester United.
Fair, McCubs. I'm not going to ask you that question. I just wanted to ask, was there any other result in Europe in the Champions League that caught your eye this week, or any other talking point you wanted to bring up? Anyone to watch? I don't know. What did you make of it?
I'm trying to think. I think that Shakhtar one is the one, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
I can't really look beyond that aside from anything else we saw. Obviously, the Bayern Munich, you know, dismantling of Atletico Madrid, I thought was impressive. I actually thought Kingsley Coman was just unreal in that game, wasn't he? Really kind of showing why he, you know, was such. I feel like people kind of don't rate him as much as maybe when he was kind of first coming through, just because of his kind of injury problems and whatnot. But obviously got that goal in the Champions League final, didn't he? And yeah, I think he was Bayern's best attacker against Atleti. Just ran that defence ragged, didn't he? So yeah, I think Bayern Munich kind of showed why they're still favourites, essentially, especially after Liverpool, who you would put as the kind of second favourites after they had a fairly kind of mediocre display against Ajax, didn't they? Go and check out yesterday's UCL review if you want to hear more about that. But actually, out of those three teams, I feel like Lazio, I don't know, like just because they're in a slightly weaker group, like they might, I think they've got like maybe an outside shout after beating Borussia Dortmund of maybe even topping that group, whereas I feel like United and Borussia Mönchengladbach, I don't back either of them to win their group. So I don't know, just on the fact that they might get a more favourable draw in the last 16 if they do get through, I think Lazio might be that dark horse for like a quarterfinal place.
Oh yeah, just on the thought of Bayern Munich, that Talisso goal, I think will be hard to top in this year's competition. What a strike. And also a quick shout out to Angelino as well, whose first goal I think it was, for so RB Leipzig against Istanbul Başakşehir was absolutely awesome. Turned into prime Bergkamp for a second. was just incredible. And I've been banging the drum on Twitter, as I like to do. I just get one agenda and I stick to it, that Pep Guardiola made a massive mistake in loaning him out to RB Leipzig this season, with Benjamin Mendy looking a shadow of his former self. But anyway, that's a debate for another time. But guys, we want to know, who are your dark horses in this year's Champions League competition? And who are you most impressed with and why? Let us know in the comments and let's move on to the biggest of big match previews. Yes, that's right. It is the big one this weekend. There's other games in Europe, but really all eyes at Saturday 3 p.m. will be turning to Spain and the Camp Nou, where Barcelona host Real Madrid, where I didn't actually realise until I was reading this script, which was excellently prepared by McCubs, how even the record is. Barcelona 97 wins to Madrid's 96. That's awesome. And Real's 2-0 win back in March was actually their first in 10 meetings. And last season marked the first time the Blaugrana hadn't won a Clasico home or away since 2012-13. So, you know, a couple of mixed messages there. They'll want to, you know, re-grab the ascendancy that they've had for a few years in this fixture. But obviously, they both go into this game in pretty different form. Barcelona demolished their Hungarian opponents on Tuesday. Real Madrid, as we've said, were embarrassed by Shakhtar Donetsk at home last night on Wednesday. But Henry, let's kick off with Barcelona. Oh, a topsy-turvy start to the season, you might say, or maybe not as convincing as you would like, or is that a bit harsh?
Yeah, so a really kind of interesting kind of start under Ronald Koeman. I think it's almost gone better than they maybe would have expected. If we take aside their 1-0 defeat to Getafe last weekend, where they took just 7 shots with a sort of, half-hearted Lionel Messi accounting for almost half of those, and just two coming from inside the box of stoppage time. I think Ronald Koeman's already saying that he thinks he can get more out of Messi, and Messi's maybe not trying enough, which isn't a good sign of four games. But yeah, I mean, obviously they beat Villarreal 4-0 on the opening day. Then since then, I think a draw against Sevilla's, I mean, I don't want to say that's a good result for Barcelona, because Barcelona should always be looking to win games, no matter who they're playing. But, you know, Sevilla, probably kind of one of the form teams of La Liga. The draw there is good. And then sort of a semi-unconvincing win against Celta Vigo in the pouring rain, if I remember correctly. If we look at their team, I mean, there's Antoine Griezmann. They obviously have kept with him, but he really doesn't look like a happy man in Barcelona at all this season. Yet to contribute a goal or assist in four starts. Yeah, he's only averaging 1.7 shots per 90, which is a career low for the Frenchman. And he hasn't created a chance in 265 minutes of league action. It's worth reminding ourselves that he's being currently played on the right side of the attack for Barcelona at the moment, where he's really not very happy about it. I think, you know, for France, he tends to play either as a central striker or just behind the striker, behind Giroud there. And, you know, he even said on international duty, "Deschamps knows where to play me in regards to getting the best through the middle from the striker." Yeah, you know, against Getafe, they played Pedri, the 17-year-old, who did actually score against Ferencvaros last night. They played him then. So once again, Griezmann wasn't quite able to play where he wanted to, and Koeman's not getting the best out of him right now. And Koeman really needs a reaction from his players here, because in the three games since Villarreal, they've only clocked up one expected goal just once. That was against Sevilla, and have been bested on XG in their last two fixtures. And obviously they did beat the Hungarian outfit Ferencvaros 5-1, in the Champions League. But they got caught cold in the opening 10 minutes. The Hungarian side really took it to them. And it was only once they sort of got a goal and relaxed into the game, Barcelona began to overplay them, and some of the better players come through. Ousmane Dembele looked better. But yeah, it wasn't the best opening start for Barcelona there. But one player who is looking better for Barca right now is Frenkie de Jong, who's been given more responsibility in Koeman's 4-2-3-1. He's now making 2.6 tackles and interceptions per 90, up from 1.9 last term. And also 2.8 dribbles per game. That's 100% success rate, up from 2 last season. I mean, he sort of got a bit of unfair... I thought he's unfairly criticised last season. I thought he started the season really strongly for Barcelona. I think he maybe just got caught up in the general kind of politics and issues at the club. I think it's never an easy situation for a young guy like that to join a team which is in some kind of... dispute and whatnot. And yeah, so I think he's playing his way into being a Barcelona player, and I've got, you know, no worries about De Jong and his future there. You know, his new role's also getting the best at Busquets too. He's now able to press more freely, currently making 6.9 successful pressures per 90, which is the best in the squad, and an excellent 44% success rate with those pressures too. Just quickly, I want to talk about Ansu Fati. I don't care what Joe Tomlinson says. I think Ansu Fati is the best teenager in world football right now. It's not Mason Greenwood. You know, he's got 3 goals recently. He's just looked awesome. And, you know, Fati's looked awesome for Spain as well, for Barcelona. I think he's really stepped up, and I think he's an unbelievable discovery for that side. And also Philip Coutinho, it's really great to see him playing well again. 1 goal and 2 assists. And they both did well in the game in the Champions League. So yeah, I think, you know, you guys have got some stats about the last time a Clasico went into a situation like this, you know, where both teams, neither team are looking particularly promising. It's really hard to call this one, but I mean, we'll go on to Real Madrid. But yeah, it's an interesting time for Barcelona. I mean, they can either look really impressive or look awful. It's one of the two, really.
Yeah, and seemingly no middle ground. That stat, just while we're on it, is that neither side... The last time both sides went into El Clasico having lost their previous league game was 2003, which really does show the state of both sides at the moment. I actually thought Trincao was particularly good against Ferencvaros as well. Looked excellent. I think Griezmann, I wouldn't be surprised if he didn't start this game, to be totally honest, although I do feel a certain amount of... I suppose I've got a certain amount of empathy for him. I don't think he's being utilised in his best position. I don't think the players around him trust him as a member of the sort of front line in the same way that they do Ansu Fati or Messi, obviously. So Griezmann, it continues the struggle there, really. But McCubs, let's move on to Real Madrid, because weirdly, this feels like a bigger game for Real Madrid given the events of this week. I mean, if they lose this is chaos, really.
Yeah, I mean, three losses in a week is not, you know, not something that Zidane's used to, is he? Yeah, obviously they come off the back of that embarrassing defeat to Shakhtar Donetsk in the Champions League. Like we said, you know, there's a bit more on that in yesterday's UCL review. But I'll skirt over it a little bit now, because despite putting out a strong side, you know, Zidane did still rest some key players in attack. You know, he opted for that front three of Asensio, Jovic and Rodrigo. You know, none of them were particularly effective, especially in the first half. I thought Jovic proved once again why I don't think he's trusted by Zidane. I just don't think he's got that killer instinct yet in the box for Los Blancos. So yeah, Benzema would surely come back into the first 11 for El Clasico. I think he was probably rested with a view to Saturday. And he'll probably also be joined by Vinicius Jr., I'd expect. Obviously, he scored with his first touch against Shakhtar Donetsk after coming on for Jovic about halfway through the second half. And that pair lead the Real squad for shots this season. They're both on 3.8 per 90, which is excellent. Vinicius actually is top for shots in the box with 2.9. But obviously, as we've discussed before, his finishing is still leaving a lot to be desired, isn't it? Last weekend against Cadiz, none of his four shots hit the target. I think, you know, I think he took more than anyone else on the pitch, but none of them hit the target. So yeah, I think in this game, Real Madrid really needs to be on top of their, really need to be kind of at their clinical best if they want to overcome Barca away. But also I think their defence, that defence has just been a real concern, hasn't it, the last two games. They kept three clean sheets in their first four matches of the season, but they were so sloppy against Cadiz and Shakhtar. Obviously, Danny Carvajal's out. He's one of Zidane's most trusted acolytes, isn't he? Nacho filled in against Cadiz, and then it was Ferland Mendy actually playing out of position on the right, wasn't it, against Shakhtar?
Yeah.
But they were particularly open down that right side against Cadiz, at least. The visitors had racked up 0.77 XG against Real Madrid's 1.14. And I think it was Lozano who got the goal for Cadiz. I think he was really running riot down the right of Madrid's defence and cutting inside. So yeah, I think Zidane is obviously, you know, willing Carvajal back to the side. I think he's not going to be back until early December. But also the midfield, it's going to be interesting to see what he does with the midfield, because he went for a midfield three of Kroos, Modric and Isco against Cadiz, which is pretty attack minded. At least there isn't that kind of, you know, they're obviously missing the presence of Casemiro in there, I thought, and Fede Valverde. You know, they notched up 14 tackles and interceptions between them against Shakhtar. So yeah, I think it will be interesting to see how he shapes that midfield, because they need to get that balance right. Obviously, they need to, you know, I think they need to have Casemiro in there to kind of combat the Barca attack, especially if, as we expect, probably Coutinho will probably come back into that side. But, you know, they also need to have some creativity there as well, because all of their creativity has been coming from the midfield this term. I think Toni Kroos has 3.3 key passes per game, which is the most in the squad, and he's followed by Modric on 2.2. So yeah, with that forward line not looking quite as good as it did kind of towards the end of last season, a lot of that a lot of that chance creation is having to come from the middle third. So yeah, I think that's probably where this game's going to be won and lost, is how Zidane sets up that midfield. Because if say Casemiro and Valverde can kind of blunt the threat of, say, Fati and say Coutinho, then I think Madrid will have a really good shot. But if not, I think this could be Barca's for the taking.
It's interesting, your point about creativity from midfield. I think it's a good one, because Vinicius Jr. is improving as a finisher. He's getting far more direct, and his dribbling's always been excellent, and his finishing, as I said, is improving. And Rodrigo on the other side is still painfully inconsistent, although don't want to be too harsh on someone so young. But both of them do need to up their creativity. I think Benzema often seems like he has to carve out most of his chances by himself at times. So it's difficult for Real Madrid, and yet they're in a sort of weird situation, Real Madrid, because they need Sergio Ramos and Benzema. They're their two best players, or at least were last season. But yet they also need to start looking beyond them. And whenever Zidane tries to give an opportunity to Eder Militao or Jovic up front, it just... The drop-off is just so massive, and it really causes huge issues throughout the side. But good news for Zidane is that Sergio Ramos and Odriozola should be back for this game, so he won't have to persist with Ferland Mondi on the right-hand side. However, Eden Hazard is still on the sidelines. Who knows when he'll come back, whether he'll ever be really the same player, to be honest. It's quite sad what's happened to Hazard, although I do have very little sympathy with the way he keeps himself in shape over the off-season. Martin Odegaard is also not expected to be back until late November. Barcelona, Ter Stegen's out for a month, so Neto will stay in goal. Umtiti remains a major doubt. Jordi Alba could return to the squad, but will most likely start on the bench. So maybe it will be Serginho Dest who continues playing at the left back, or at least that's what happened against Getafe with Sergio Roberto on the right hand side. And yeah, as we said before, Barcelona have definitely had the better of this head to head in recent years, but Real Madrid did get that crucial win against them last season, winning 2-0 with Vinicius and Mariano Diaz scoring in March 2020. Although both teams seem like they have gone through a hell of a lot of change since then. You know, Barcelona in the dugout and on the pitch, and Real Madrid in terms of who's fit and available. So it's going to be a fascinating matchup. Henry, everyone's been wanting it. What is your score prediction?
I'm sure they have. I think the Messi factor is too big to write off in this game. I think he's genuinely just going to be the difference between the two. I'm going to go for 2-0 to Barcelona.
Oh, McCubs, what do you reckon?
Yeah, I might go for a similar one, actually. I just feel like, you know, regardless of form, and, you know, neither of these sides have been in great form in the last 2 weeks. I just feel like, yeah, Barca tend to come out on top in these games. So, I'm going to go for 3-1. And I think this could be, you know, Henry was talking about Frankie de Jong. I feel like this could be a game in which Frankie de Jong maybe announces himself a bit more. Because he's already announced himself, obviously. And has announced himself against Real Madrid, against Ajax. When they played Ajax, sorry, in the Champions League, didn't he? But as a Barcelona player, I think he could... Yeah, he could.
I know what you mean. Firmly, like, establishes himself as the main man. It's difficult after the week they've had to look past Barcelona. But I actually think it'll be really tight. I think Ramos coming back is a major factor. True. I don't think Courtois can really have a worse performance than he did against Shakhtar as well. Varane needs to pull his finger out. Maybe he'll be dropped for Eder Militao, although he wasn't much better, to be honest. Maybe Nacho will play alongside Sergio Ramos. I'm not quite sure, to be honest. But major question marks. You're just looking for a prediction. I'm going to go 1-1, actually. Just 1-1. Yeah. Not the most entertaining prediction, but you guys certainly brought enough drama. Get your score predictions in the comments down below, and let's move on to our quickfire question. Our quickfire question this week comes from @MauroPayne_R, and it's, can you see Pochettino taking over at PSG? Now, McCubs, we've just had a scout report dropping this, haven't we?
Yeah, nice little opportunity to plug it. Yeah, yesterday, scout report about where Pochettino will go next, where should he go next. We talk about PSG, Man United and Borussia Dortmund as well, which I know are a favourite of yours, Doogie, as a Pochettino destination. So yeah, go and check that out. We do a good deep dive on that. But I think the simple answer is, I think yes, personally. I think if Thomas Tuchel is in as much danger as we perhaps think he is at PSG, and he does get the sack, or even if, you know, it's clear that his contract isn't going to get renewed at the end of the season and PSG go in for Poch, that's the thing. I think if PSG go in for Poch, I just feel like he'll struggle to turn them down. Just because of the history that he has at that club, obviously captained them in the early noughties. I don't think it's necessarily the ideal project for him, but I just think that, I don't know, I just think he'll really struggle to turn it down. I think, you know, he's spoken with a lot of admiration about the club in the past, has said that he'd love to manage them in the past. So, yeah, I just think it's too good. It's a too good a job for him to turn down if it comes around.
Fair. Henry, where would you want to see Pochettino go next?
I hadn't realised that about him being captain there at PSG, because I was originally going to say no, I don't think that would entice him. I think he's looking for the right kind of thing. I don't know if it's, you know, because winning Liga, which takes up most of the time, is almost like a foregone conclusion most of the time, and just focusing on the Champions League, I think it's quite taxing. I personally still think he's holding out for an English job. I still think Manchester United, unfairly, in my opinion, Ole Gunnar Solskjaer getting criticism there, but I still think he's always going to be lurking around the edges there. I also think Chelsea as well. I'm going to throw that in there. Ooh. If Frank Lampard continues to underperform,
wow, that's such a hot take. I mean, not a hot.
That
take,
is not,
but that's such a massive shout.
It's honestly, McCubs, it's not that outrageous. I really don't think it is.
Even if Frank Lampard doesn't, manager though, like, I just feel like that rivalry would be too much.
I mean, Mourinho's done it about four times. He doesn't care.
What did he say? Oh, the reason he's at Spurs is because Chelsea sacked me. I think it's the same principle. At the end of the day, I don't think a Chelsea fan would look at what Pochettino did. He's a world-class coach. Let's remember, he's a world-class coach and tactician, which I'm not quite sure Frank Lampard has proved himself to be as of yet. And I think if you're looking for someone to go in there and use all their amazing summer additions and turn them into something quite cohesive and strong, that's where I think Pochettino would be effective. I don't think this idea of, you manage here, therefore you can't manage there, I don't think that really exists when it comes to success. The money's too much.
I agree. Like, Pochettino would do an amazing job at Chelsea. I mean, he'd do an amazing job at a lot of places, but with Chelsea's resources and their young players, like, it would be an amazing project for him, for sure. I just don't see it happen. Like, I don't see the possibility.
Guardiola's not going to be leaving City anytime soon, in my opinion. Arsenal's not going anywhere. Well, I mean, maybe at the end of the year. Certainly not mid-season. I think maybe at the end of the year. If we're talking about him taking a job within the next sort of 6 to 12 months, let's say, then this is where I think the big jobs, which are most at risk, in my opinion, are United and maybe even Chelsea. If Frank Lampard can't, get this team pairing as quickly as possible. And that's where I think he would be interesting, because I think he'd be a favourite for both jobs, with Premier League pedigree and a pedigree of using players and improving a team with what he's got.
He would absolutely love Mateo Kovacic. He would be awesome under Pochettino. Yeah, be like Dembele on steroids. It'd be awesome. I am going to go for... I also said Chelsea or Man United on the Extra Time podcast last week, so I'll do something different.
Hey, really?
I still want him to go to Dortmund, but I'm not sure whether that's going to happen, to be honest. They seem fairly happy sort of muddling along under Lucien Favre, not really getting any better defensively, although some of that's, the fact they've got Roman Bürki in goal. I am going to go with Man City at the end of the year when Pep steps away, having not won the league title, which I can actually see happening. Then Pep goes to Juve, Poch comes to Man City, everyone's happy, and Man United stay mediocre, which is what I can see happening as well. But guys, that was a great... I mean, maybe we should do a whole deep discussion on this, but definitely go check out the scout report, which McCubs wrote. I think, was it you, McCubs?
Yeah.
That McCubs wrote, which went out on EFD yesterday. And that's all we've got time for on Continental Club for this week. I hope you enjoyed it. It was an absolute marathon show. El Clasico, Champions League, Pochettino. We really do treat you on a Friday afternoon. I hope you enjoy it. Have a great weekend, guys. But before we do that, Henry, what should they go and watch other than the scout report?
just keep, we've got some really interesting top 10s and XIs coming out now. We've got a sort of Halloween special in the works. Just keep an eye out on those. And yeah, exciting times to be a subscriber to Football Daily. And Euro Football Daily, I should say.
Absolutely, yeah. Spooky videos on the way. Thank you very much for watching, guys. We'll see you next time. Bye.